You're watching the Fark Elite Series, fueled by Smash Beer on OEN. Brought to you this week by Prolapse, the only timing and scoring system used in Fark Racing. We've got two races for you this week on two tracks that could not be more different. First, we have the temporary dirt oval inside the Tulsa Expo Center in Oklahoma, and then we move on to Watkins Glen International in New York. The Prolapse 100 at the Tulsa Expo Center saw the first 50-50 sprint races of the season, and the track promoters threw a little twist into the mix after qualifying. The pole winner would roll a die, and that determined how many people would be inverted for the start. Jacob Walls, driving the MT Motorsports 44 this week, took his first career Carl's P1 award for a 50-50 sprint number one, but he started 10th after rolling a 5, and on lap 7, he ended up against the wall on his side. Ryan Matthews, defending series champion, caught up in it as well. Packer Carroll found himself at the front of the field on the white flag lap. Kurt Walker trying to chase him down, but Walker spins up into the wall entering turn 3, and Packer Carroll returns to victory lane in the Fark Elite Series fueled by Smash Beer. We've got a lot of good finishes from the small teams that don't run up front very often, at the expense of some of the usual front runners. Tracy King, making his Fark debut, comes home in 6th place and grabs the hard charger bonus, 10 points. 21 cars started the race, 9 cars took the final restart, but the top 12 will transfer into the 100-lap feature, except for Mike Malone, who crashed heavily and would not be able to repair his car, so that will bump Bob Steffens into the feature as per Fark rules. And once again, tough break for Ryan Matthews and Jacob Walls. Walls, again, got his first pole and then crashed out on lap 7. Harry Asinola won the Carl's P1 award for sprint number 2, and he came up with a 6 when he rolled the die, which meant that the whole field would be inverted for the start. Aaron Singer led the field to the green flag, but look at that stack up! As all the fast guys try to get past the slower cars, it all goes horribly wrong! And a massive crash at the entrance to pit road on the first lap of the race. 8 cars of the 20 starters were taken out in this wreck alone, but fortunately everyone climbed out of their cars, and it would be Tammy Barnton surviving the carnage and taking home her first Fark victory since she took the Smash Beer 200 in 2014. Kyle Gaffigan finishes a very strong 2nd place in the 2nd Desert Star car, teammate to Bradley Carlisle. Aaron Singer, Mark Thompson, and Danica Hollifield. Very good finishes for all 3 of them. Joshua Pacer is the highest finishing rookie. Unfortunately for Harry Asinola, he went out of the race after winning the pole, but he will be back for the feature with a backup car. Johnson Clapp came home 11th, but he blew his engine, so he will not be able to start the feature, which bumps Carter Fitzgerald into the field, and then Fitzgerald gave up her spot for her teammate Ryan Matthews. And now with the 50-50 sprints out of the way, it is now time for the Prolapse 100. Rip Tyler, your points leader, on the Carl's pole. Taylor Brillen, outside of the front row, already sliding into the outside wall. And that's a huge wad of cars exiting turn 2. And Gabriel Messina finds himself sliding into the end of the pit wall. Bob Steffens spinning into the pit lane. Lap 7 on the restart. Tammy Barnton, winner of sprint number 1, now finds herself embedded in the hay bales down there. Bob Steffens lost a lap after spinning into the pit lane, and he just barely misses getting back onto the lead lap, coming back to the caution. Packer Carroll, winner of sprint 2, now sliding into the pit wall. Cyrus Laterza joins him and flips the 17 onto its roof. That would be 2 cars that Laterza has wrecked tonight. Rip Tyler found himself trapped behind the 26 of Danica Hollifield on the restart. Taylor Brillen, Bradley Carlisle take advantage. Hollifield makes a move for the pit lane, swerving right in front of the 16. And Tyler clips the end of the pit wall, and that's just enough to take Rip Tyler out of the race from first to worst very quickly. And that's a very nice time for Kyle Cobb to rejoin the field right as Bradley Carlisle leads to the restart. So that's going to give Carlisle an advantage. Bob Steffens still trailing the leader, trying to get back onto the lead lap. That's Ryan Matthews, who's already made his way back up into 2nd place. But Tracy King gets squeezed into the wall and goes up into the air. but he quickly gets the car pointed in the right direction and drives away. Taylor Brillin in car 9. That car is smoking. Brillin is done. But Tracy King soldiers on as he tries to survive his first FARC weekend. Bradley Carlisle continues to lead. Bob Steffens still trying to challenge, and that's still a hornet's nest back there. A quarter of the way through this race, and there's no end in sight for the chaos. Caution is out. Bob Steffens sneaks by the 83 at the line. So Bob Steffens is now back on the lead lap. Kyle Gaffigan and Trey Ashby find themselves in the wall. That's what the caution was for. I'm not sure why. I think at this point, with so many cautions at the beginning of the race, it's just an impulse for the flagman at this point. Harry Espinola, after the restart, charges his way forward and moves into second place. Harry Espinola has become very good at surviving these attrition-filled races, which is what this race is certainly shaping up to be. Bob Steffens got himself back on the lead lap on the last caution, and he's now taking advantage of that, charging his way through the field as well. And now he is up to third place after getting by Kurt Walker in the 98. Walker trying to come back after him. Bob Steffens, one of the fastest cars on the track right now, has never won a race in the FARC Elite Series fueled by Smash Beer. Things started to settle down a little bit as we approach lap number 40. We're looking at Todd Rowe in car 28 for Flying High Motorsports. He has made his way up to 8th place. Tracy King, after that crash, is now back to 13th place. He tries to get by Aaron Singer. Trey Ashby gets stuffed into the wall by Caden Beckett. And now Singer tries to turn the 77 around entering turn 1. And that's going to bring out the caution right as I say that things were settling down. Bradley Carlisle continues to lead the race. Harry Espinola and Bob Steffens putting the pressure on him. Enola right on the back of the 83. And Carlisle gets turned around across the nose of Bob Steffens. Enola gets swept up in it. Mark Thompson comes flying in there. The leaders were really boxed in by the lapped cars of Hollifield and King, but that's going to hand the lead over to Bob Steffens. Tracy King trying to get back onto the lead lap. Kurt Walker almost gets turned around, gets that car settled. Caden Beckett smacks the wall really hard. But Caden Beckett's hit the wall so many times today. But King now wrestles that 77 by Bob Steffens, and I think that's going to put him back on the lead lap. Here's what happened to Kurt Walker. He gets tagged by Mark Thompson, but Walker keeps it in the right direction, showing why he's a two-time champion in this series. But Walker would soon drop back and find himself in the clutches of Bradley Carlisle, who wastes no time charging back up through the field. Carlisle has failed to finish a race this season, aside from the rookie shootout, which he won. As we see Tracy King, his race comes to an end on lap number 55 against the pit wall. The same pit wall that's bitten so many other people today. Bob Steffens continues to lead on the restart. Harry Espinola trying to fend off the hornet's nest behind him of the lead lap cars and lapped cars. Under 40 laps to go now. Trey Ashby in the 47 now making some moves for the Joel Rodriguez own team. Ashby's sprint was the first race that he finished this season. But now he comes under attack from Harry Espinola and Caden Beckett, though Beckett is off the lead lap. But Ashby is putting together a very good weekend so far, despite the damage to that car. But to be fair, everybody's car has some kind of damage at this point. Ryan Matthews is now running in fourth place. Matthews, the defending series champion, already has a win this season coming at Columbia, but he failed to finish at Nashville. Danica Hollifield in the FARC Modified got back onto the lead lap on a previous caution. She currently runs seventh behind Bradley Carlisle. It would have been two Peak Williamson cars in this race if her teammate Johnson Clapp had a spare motor, but of course he blew up in his sprint and could not take the start. But Hollifield is doing a very good job carrying the flag for that team so far. Bob Steffens has pulled away from second place, and he's now trying to run down and pass Caden Beckett, put the 06 in his mirrors, which is the safest place for that 06 to be. He's been all over the place today. There is second place Harry Espinola trying to chase down Bob Steffens and possibly take a second win for Tom Delgado Racing in this weekend. Bradley Carlisle back up to third now, but it's a pretty lonely third place. It's a long way to Harry Esanola, but he's got a comfortable gap over fourth place Kurt Walker. Walker may potentially have some competition in Todd Rowe, car number 28, but Rowe is currently being chased down by Ryan Matthews and Trey Ashby. Ashby really fell off during this run after getting up to second place, and Matthews now into the back of Todd Rowe. That turns the 28 around and brings out the Vicker Collision and Glass Caution with just 15 laps to go. Cautions at the end of this race are the last thing that Bob Steffens wants to see, but he's got a couple lapped cars on the restart, acting as a cushion between him and Harry Esanola, and Steffens rockets off to the into the lead. Enola gets shoved out of line by Bradley Carlisle and Mark Thompson. I believe Mark Thompson is still on the lead lap, so that puts Thompson up to third place. Enola, who had one of the fastest cars aside from Bob Steffens, it now finds himself in a big hole as Bob Steffens rounds turn four. Two laps to go, but the caution is out. Bob Steffens takes the Vicker Collision Glass caution and is going to settle behind the pace car. And here's what brought out the caution. Todd Rowe getting into the back of Kyle Cobb in the 97. Danica Hollifield clips the 97. That's got to be gut-wrenching for Bob Steffens, because now Steffens has to survive a green-white checkered. The race will be red-flagged, and teams will be given 15 minutes to repair damage and change tires. And Steffens just has to survive two more laps. Bob Steffens has never won a race after competing in this series for so many years. Steffens will take the green flag. Ryan Matthews to his outside, but Steffens leaves a hole for Harry Esanola. Enola to the inside of Steffens, three wide with Matthews very briefly. Mark Thompson gets turned around as Harry Esanola sweeps into the lead. Steffens hits the wall, and he's going to be in third. And here's a better look at Mark Thompson as he washes up into Bradley Carlisle and smashes into the end of the pit wall. We've got another green-white checkered coming in FARC. They extend the race as many times as needed to get a green flag finish. Enola leads at the end of lap 102, the first overtime period. Bob Steffens out of the lead, but now he's in third. He needs to find a hole, but he doesn't get a good start. Enola secures the lead, heading into turn one. Steffens trying to come after Ryan Matthews. Matthews into the wall. Bob Steffens now back into second place, but he does not have a good run on Harry Esanola coming to the white flag. These are the first laps that Enola has led all night, but they're the ones that matter the most. Into turn three, Bob Steffens slides up into the wall, and he's going to lose a ton of time as Harry Esanola takes the Prolapse 100 at the last second. And Bob Steffens' frustrations are going to climax on the end of the pit wall. What a heartbreak for Bob Steffens to be bitten by the second-to-last caution like that. But Steffens keeps it going, and he's going to cross the line in eighth. Harry Esanola, with his first win in a couple of years, also gains 7 bonus points for starting in fourth place. Kurt Walker, Ryan Matthews round out the top three. Caden Beckett and Aaron Singer. Great finishes for the both of them. They've been struggling quite a bit in their FARC careers. It was also a great night for Todd Rowe, Trey Ashby, and Danica Hollifield. Mark Thompson comes home 11th. That's one of the best performances we've seen from him. Tracy King did his best to survive his very rude introduction to FARC competition. He will still leave with a respectable result despite failing to finish the race. And the 20 bonus points that Rip Tyler got for winning the Carl's P1 award will prevent Bob Steffens from gaining too much ground on him. And with the chaotic Prolapse 100 out of the way, we will now bring you the Jinx Power at the Glen. It would be a doubleheader with the Master Spark Modified Series at Watkins Glen International, the first road course race of the year for both of these series. 57 cars took to the track for Carl's P1 qualifying, including several modified teams fielding one-off entries for the Elite Series race. 42 cars would start the race, the 40 fastest, plus two provisionals for the first two modified teams that failed to make it in on speed. The provisionals went to Nazrin Mahmood and Jeff Wilkins, who were both caught up in the same wreck in the modified race. We've got some surprises on this DNQ list. Stanichev, Daiho, and Miura, we expected them to be strong on a road course. Rick Head failed to qualify in the Black Diamond car. Taylor Brillen failed to qualify for M&J. So those are two very strong cars that would not make the field. And now to bring you the highlights of the Jinx Power at the Glen, Antonio Guerrero, the Mexican, making his first start of the season, took the Carl's P1 award, leading Cyrus Laterza down into turn number one. Laterza looked like he was going to try to make a move on the right side of Guerrero going into one, but thought better of it. Guerrero, in one of the two Devin Rogers cars, takes the early lead. His teammate Jamie Flock started in 11th. And no, you are not seeing things. That is a Team Burr car trying to make a move on a Matthews car. Gary Miles into the back of Carter Fitzgerald entering turn number one. Former sports car driver and FARC road course winner Gary Miles is behind the wheel of that 54 for this race. And already his experience is doing wonders for that team. He qualified 35th, is now up to 34th place and trying to challenge Carter Fitzgerald. Packer Carroll has to pit the 71 on lap 3 with a minor problem, but he's going to get that car back out there. Greg Gray in the 78, very slow entering the bus stop. Lawrence Burr runs into the back of him. Lawrence Burr is going to limp that car back to the pit lane and get some repairs done, but McSwain Tech's woes are continuing here in 2015. They've only got a few weeks left until the Advanced Motorsports Engineering Program, which fields that car, ends for the year. Now we're looking at Jeff Wilkins in the 44W, one of the modified provisionals. He's not really making the most of that. In fact, he's been in the wall a couple times. Both sides of that car are damaged. And here's the other recipient of the modified provisional, Nazrin Mahmood in the 108 for Racing Fever. Mahmood goes a lap down. She and Jeff Wilkins were in the same accident early on in the modified race. They both got taken out. Mahmood, who hails from Silicon Valley, is the first driver of Bangladeshi descent to enter a FARC Elite Series race, but her lack of experience and the lack of resources over at Fever Racing are really holding the both of them back, and there's that lack of experience right there. Mahmood goes into the wall in the S's and turns the car around. The Vicker Collision and Glass caution would be thrown for this, even though she quickly got the car going again. But there you have it, the first race stoppage here on lap number 9 of 50, as Mahmood limps the car around the track. She hasn't been faring much better in the Master Spark modifieds either. A whole bunch of cars coming down pit road under this first caution. Antonio Guerrero still leads the race, and he will lead on the restart, but Brian Sendak leapfrogs into second place in the Black Diamond racing car. The former Master Cup Series driver Brian Sendak carrying the flag for Black Diamond in this race after Rick Head failed to qualify, as we see Isaac Leitner going around and getting a little bit of help from his teammate Packer Carroll. That's not the first time those two have gotten together this season. Carter Fitzgerald and Robert Lechleiter were both collected, so that puts us under another Vicker Collision and Glass caution. Robert Lechleiter would drop out of the race and finish 42nd. Antonio Guerrero comes down the pit lane again, but we have a few cars staying out, including Bob Steffens, who stays out to take the lead, but here comes Rip Tyler around the 7 on the restart to take the lead. Bob Steffens trying to forget the heartbreak at Tulsa, doing pretty well for himself at the moment, but he just wasn't able to hold off Rip Tyler. 24th place belongs to Trey Ashby at the moment in the Jinx Power Lennard. Of course, Jinx Power being the race engine manufacturer owned by his car owner, Joel Rodriguez. So very nice to see Rodriguez putting up the sponsorship for this race. But Kiki Hizuno is trying to rough up the 47. Obviously, she feels that he's holding her up, but Hizuno's going to lose that spot to Ryan Matthews. A bit further up the track, we see that Gary Miles has made his way up to 20th place. Once again, I must stress, in the Team Burr car, that team acquired a former Matthews Motorsports TM Lights car for this race, and Gary Miles brought on his old crew chief and some of the staff that used to work on his sports cars, and from what I've heard, they really whipped that team into shape, and we can see it on the track right now. Antonio Guerrero lost the lead after some of these guys did not pit on the last caution, but he's working his way back through the field now, getting around the three of Laura Cyrus for fifth place. And ahead of him is the white 52 of Ross Carter in one of the Messina cars. His teammate Jamie Flock running a bit further back in 12th place, stuck behind the 717 of Scott Dalitz. Dalitz making his first start of the year in that impossible-to-miss 717 car. Ryan Matthews, defending series champion, gets into the back of Kay Taylor heading into the bus stop. And that will bring out another Vicker Collision and Glass caution. The battle for 24th place goes awry for Kay Taylor. Kay Taylor is also making his first start of the season. And look how well that's going for him so far. Scott Dalitz has gotten into an accident under caution somewhere on the track. That 717 car completely smashed up, and he will have to drop out. Rip Tyler leads the takers on pit road this time around. And that will put Bob Steffens back in the lead. Zach Webster, car 41, is the last car on the lead lap. Steffens trying to hold off, I believe that's Ross Carter in car 52, one of the three Messina cars in this race. Brian Sendak in third. Antonio Guerrero restarted 27th, but runs right through the back of Nazrin Mahmood. And that puts Kelly Posadas up and into the air. The 88 did a complete barrel roll, but keeps going. That just goes to show you what a great option these secondhand TM Lights cars are for some of these teams. Of course, Hotshot Racing runs some secondhand TM Lights Nemotos in this series, and those are definitely some very durable cars. Coming back to the Vicker Collision and Glass Caution, Zach Webster stayed in front of leader Bob Steffens and would rejoin the tail end of the lead lap. Three wide after the restart. Ross Carter took over the lead after Bob Steffens pitted, but Cyrus Lotaris and Brian Sendak dive right past the 52. And now they battle for the lead amongst themselves, side by side, cars 17 and 08. But Brian Sendak gets the run off the S's and will take over the race lead. Ross Carter now coming back after Cyrus Laterza for a second, but Laterza has the better run coming into the bus stop. Trey Ashby in car 47 is up in smoke. The Jinx engine on fire in the race sponsored by Jinx Engines. If I were Joel Rodriguez, I would probably go hide somewhere for a little bit. Cyrus Laterza now in trouble in car 17, and Bigsby Foote smashes right into the back of him. Bob Steffens and Jason Bates collected, and you saw Packer Carroll go spinning. He tries to get through, but runs into Bigsby Foote, who tries to get back going and backs that 71 car into the wall. That's the second accident that Packer Carroll has been involved in today. Harry Essanola running in third place after the restart. Michael Madrigal in the pie car right behind him. Michael Madrigal and Jeremy Baker are splitting that pie car. Madrigal is running the road courses, and we definitely see why the team made that decision to enter Madrigal in these races. He's running up in the top five for them. Ryan Matthews now knocking on the door of the top five. Running in between Libby Bell and Tom Delgado, Rip Tyler sitting there in eighth place. It was a rocky start to this race for Ryan Matthews. He started deep in the field. He now hits the wall, allows Tom Delgado to sneak by him. So he still got a little bit of work to do. He also had that incident with Kate Taylor. Kiki Hitsuno and Zach Webster getting into it. Leslie Riggs comes in and makes it a little bit worse, and Hitsuno goes right into the tire barrier at the end of the bus stop. Another Vicker Collision and Glass caution right there, but Antonio Guerrero running 13th after the restart. Right behind is Devin Rogers' teammate Jamie Flock in the number 01. Guerrero and Flock doing very well at demonstrating their respective road course abilities. Running up in the top 15 for Devin Rogers, who does not field cars in this series on a regular basis. Harry Essanola coming after Ross Carter for second place, has a very easy time of getting around the outside of the 52. It seems that Ross Carter might have a problem because now there's a train forming behind him. Leslie Riggs now in the tire barriers in the bus stop. That would be another Vicker collision and glass caution. Tom Delgado trying to gain some more ground after the restart, getting around the pie car of Michael Madrigal, slots himself into fourth place. The Tom Delgado Racing cars now trying to mount an assault on the lead, with Harry Espinola continuing to run in second and trying to chase down a Brian Sendak in the 08. Gary Miles in the Team Berg car, now up to ninth place, running behind Ryan Matthews. Laura Cyrus in the 3 right behind him. Laura Cyrus got her first career win on the road course in Bowmanville, Ontario last year. But unfortunately for her, Motor Assault Racing is now running a very reduced schedule here in 2015. Tom Delgado gets around Ross Carter for third place now, coming up to 13 laps to go. It definitely seems like Ross Carter appears to have the speed right on the restart, but then a lap or two later, he really falls off and starts to hold people up. Isaac Leitner now gets together with Bob Steffens through the bus stop, goes spinning through the grass, and that's not going to be a caution. Luke Pellerin in car 25 decided to do a little bit of rally cross there as well. The Devin Rogers cars are having a hard time getting around Gary Miles now. I cannot say enough about what Gary Miles and his crew have done for Team Burr this weekend. He's a highly experienced road racer, bringing some highly experienced staff to that team. He isn't exactly bringing any more money than what they work with on a regular basis. Libby Bell is very slow on the track. Bell breaking down from sixth place, and she would make it back to the pit lane, but they threw the Vicker collision glass caution for her for some reason. I think she may have been leaking some oil on the track, or they thought she was going to come to a stop, and threw the caution. Rip Tyler is one of the only cars coming onto pit road under this caution, with just 8 laps to go, so huge setback for Rip Tyler in the 16. Brian Sendak continues to lead the race, trying to close the deal and get Black Diamond Racing's first win in the FARC Elite Series. Black Diamond Racing was very fast out of the gate this season, but they haven't been able to hang on for the win just yet. They've certainly got the speed to win races, though, as we see Michael Madrigal moving back into fourth place around Ross Carter. There's Ross Carter falling off, and that certainly isn't going to help him getting together with Ryan Matthews in the 61. Matthews knocking on the door of the top 5 is having a good day on paper, but he's had some issues with running into things. Gary Miles is still fending off Jamie Flock and Antonio Guerrero. We apologize for showing this 54 car so many times today, but when a Team Berg car is running in the top 10 and making on-track passes, you've got to take notice. I think I would definitely like to see Gary Miles come back later in the year at another one of the road races. It wouldn't be a bad deal for him if he ended up in a better car, but if he were to come back with Team Burr, that would be really great for them. Battle for second between teammates. Tom Delgado gets around the 45 of Harry Espinola. Tom Delgado trying to win in his home state of New York. He only has 2 wins to his name in this series, and here he comes right after the 08. Brian Sendak not putting up much of a challenge. He knows that Tom Delgado is coming, and there goes Delgado right to the inside. Sendak crowds him onto the curbing, but Delgado is still there, coming up into the S's now, still side by side through the right hander, but coming through this second curve, Delgado now has the momentum, and Tom Delgado takes over the race lead. And seconds later, Harry Espinola is going to follow suit, coming into the bus stop, getting around the 08, now making it a TDR 1-2. You can put a blanket under second through fifth place. Ross Carter trying to hang on, but his car just hasn't been that good after a couple laps of green flag racing. Bradley Carlisle almost takes out his teammate Kyle Gaffigan. The Rookie of the Year leader has some damage, but he's hanging on to the top 20, but as you saw, he almost ended his race right there. The Pearson Sweeney cars, Jason Bates and Lucas Sweeney, now taking on Packer Carroll a little bit further up the track. Lucas Sweeney is going for the Masters Park Modified Championship, not running as many races in the Elite Series this year. He utterly dominated the modified race this morning. Zach Webster, after getting back on the lead lap earlier in the race, is now up to 12th place, trying to catch the 63 of Kevin Monroe as Monroe tries to get around the 54 of Gary Miles. Tom Delgado coming up on the lapped car of Nazrin Mahmood, but fortunately gets by her without much of a problem, which is more than you can say about a few people who encountered the 108 earlier today. But Delgado, now with two laps to go, has a clear track in front of him and a massive gap back to second place. Ryan Matthews uses the 108 to get around Ross Carter for fifth place. Nazrin Mahmood being very annoying for Ross Carter in these last couple laps, but there she goes off the track and into the tire barrier and out of Ross Carter's way before Antonio Guerrero can get to him. But back up front, one of the most versatile men in racing, Tom Delgado, rounds the final corner, and he will take his third career win in the FARC Elite Series, fueled by Smash Beer in the Jinx Power at the Glen. The last time Delgado won in his own equipment was all the way back in 2008, when the series ended the season at Daytona. It's very nice to see Delgado back in victory lane, especially in front of his home crowd. 1-2 finish for Tom Delgado Racing, Brian Sendak back to third, Michael Madrigal fourth, Ryan Matthews rounded out the top five, Ross Carter got moved back to sixth, partially thanks to Nazrin Mahmood. The two Devin Rogers cars of Antonio Guerrero and Jamie Flock went at it for seventh place at the end. Gary Miles slipped back to 11th, still a phenomenal job by him and Team Burr. 14th place was hotly contested between the Pearson Sweeney teammates, Bates and Sweeney, and Kyle Gaffigan held off Bradley Carlisle for 19th place. And now for the point standings, leaving Watkins Glen, Rip Tyler still on top. He's got an 86-point lead over Bob Steffens. Harry Asinola third. Two of the other Tom Delgado cars, Cyrus Laterza and Tom Delgado himself, are in the top 10. Delgado moves up into 8th place after his win here at Watkins Glen. In fact, all four Tom Delgado drivers have now won a race in 2015. Rounding out the top 10 are Leslie Riggs and Taylor Brillen for M&J Racing. 13 points separate them. Webster and Griffin, 11th and 12th. Messina in 13th. Tammy Barnton, 14th. Mark Thompson has gotten up into 16th thanks to his great runs at Tulsa and making the double points paying race at Texas World. Bradley Carlisle and Kurt Walker are tied for 19th place. Carlisle, the only rookie in the top 20, and well, that's just fitting because he's the only rookie who's running every race.